me, hip-hop was kind of created through the DJs and, you know, through isolating the break out of a really good record. So, you know, that, I think, in itself just says sampling. They took a record and they took a sample of that record and they're doing it live and manipulating it live, you know, in front of a dance crowd or a party crowd. So, I mean, hip-hop wouldn't be if it wasn't for sampling, in my opinion.
Sampling, the art of sampling, which is most definitely an art, is reaching back to the old pop. As an artist myself, to a cup of beauty, or to just something that's artistic expression. Motown, you will notice that there are many songs that have sounded like Motown artists and musicians, both vocally and musically, because of the large body of work they produce. And this is what Motown represents, and the music sounded good.
A guy named DJ Shadow, who was the first guy to do an album, which was entirely sample-based. He's about to scratch in a vocal sample, saying something that he wants to say to his audience, but he got somebody else to say it for him. And that's the sign of like a true digger. Somebody who really spends a lot of time listening to records because they can find a sample to do anything that they want to do with it.
A lot of people, you know, had listened to, early recordings of Diana Ross, you know, or of Stevie Wonder, Little Stevie Wonder, as they say, when their mama used to play the records. If you can find a way, as we do in hip-hop, to signify something from the past in terms of this black music or this this rebellious music in many ways, then what you are doing is reappropriating your people, reappropriating yourself and your roots.
The producers that are most respected by sort of underground or people that feel that they're adhering to sort of like kind of an original, like foundations of hip-hop, kind of generally like to have a lot of obscure things like in their records, and like here, that vocal sample of that girl singing, that's like three notes, so short, and you, or the voice wire or whatever that is, you can't even really tell because he could have altered the pitch. And so like in this track, you think that like some people think sampling is really easy. It's not. You have to, especially in the early days, matching pitch on songs, stuff like that is difficult because you have to be able to hear and match things. And when a beat changes or you want to add a sample in, you have to make sure that it actually fits in the mix and then it makes sense. And it's really like kind of being a conductor with like a great knowledge of everything that people have played across recorded history.
Even if it was something that might have been used, you know, 100 times before, if you find an original way to use it and flip it and make it somewhat difficult to recognize or like unrecognizable, if you can do it in a clever and original way, then I think you can definitely be in a position that deserves some props.
I'm sure you can already recognize the sample from next episode, the Dr. Dre and Snoop Dogg song. But as you can see, it has different drums. And it sounds kind of like less prominent in the mix. The sample is sort of background. This was a New York group, and they had more traditional production style, like a New York style, and you can kind of hear the sample's a little louder, a little clearer than it was on that first one. They probably recorded it with like an MPC or something as opposed to like an SP-1200, because this is the Black Chronic that I'm going to play version of. But this is the Dre beat that you'll hear in the background. It's going to be Jay-Z over rapping over it instead of Snoop Dogg and Dre-Z. And Dre.
Allow me to reintroduce myself, my name is Ho.
I don't know if you can really tell, but it's not the same sample exactly. It's the same. It's an interpolation is what Dre really invented, this style, and he would get musicians to play when he wanted. He would listen to a record and hear it, and then he'd be like, all right, we're going to make this a hit. Let's get a good like keyboardist like Scott Storch or somebody in there. And then they would play the actual pattern out. And then, you know, you can't probably tell too well through the microphone, but it bumps way more than any of the other versions, and that's just Dre's drums and bass. You have to have an ear for it. You have to know how to best use the sample that you have.
I think it's gonna get more computer-based, laptop-based.
What it allows you to do really is fairly cheaply, you can have any instrument ever at your disposal.
People putting things together that in the past people hadn't thought of, I believe that's part of the legacy that hip-hop will leave behind.
I think in time there might be a resurgence, like kind of a throwback. I guess it kind of depends where the artists take it too, you know?
I feel like people are going to look for places that they didn't look for before for samples.
It strikes a chord.
I mean, I hope it's more guided by the artists, I guess, in 10 years than the technology.
Part of hip-hop is really sampling, and so it'll always be there on some level, whether it's underground, but I think it'll always be prevalent in the mainstream to some degree, too.
Like you white man.
Nah.
Eat a brother, you just real white man.
When we started conversing, whispering in the ear, my mind rehearsing. Hustle to pick up lines and pick up dime. This spirit on the top, exactly what's all I mind. I'm loving the way you groove and the way that you grind. Let's spit hips and a fat.
Sampling's gonna live on. Respect sampling.